have some core Java concepts, and after that you need to get into the application development for the Android platform. And when it comes to Java, basically you will be having three editions, J2SE, then J2EE, and then you will be having J2ME. So J2SE, which is purely for desktop programming, J2EE, if you categorize into two different categories, you can develop web applications and you can develop enterprise applications, and J2ME, which is for mobile applications but for a specific platform, and the platform will be Symbian operating system. So the earlier Nokia devices, they used to run on the Symbian platform. So applications which can be installed for the platform will be developed using J2ME. And out of these three editions, what is required for Android and what concepts you need to brush up in the first 1 week, 10 days time when you take it from Java. And the first concept is the plain OOPS concepts. You need to know what are the Java principles, and you need to be aware of how to write these classes and how to make use of the interfaces. And associated concept with classes, you need to have some knowledge on objects, and associated with objects you'll be having some methods what you can call, and interfaces you'll be having abstract methods. So if you have some knowledge on these concepts, it'll be good enough to understand when I'm telling you how to develop applications, and when I'm writing some code, it'll be easier for you to understand the things. And the next concept what you require is exception handling, because you are running applications on the mobile and the control will not be with you, because you develop an application, you place it on the Play Store, you ask people to download the application, and once the user has installed the application on his device, totally it becomes remote to you. So it is not installed on a server what you can access, something like a web application. So all the exception handling mechanisms should be there, placed in your application right away when the application is placed on the Play Store. So you should not give any chances for the application to get crashed or suddenly it gets hanged. This sort of scenario should not be there when the user is using your application. So that is the reason exception handling mechanisms should be in place without necessary in your Android application. And you will be having the same syntax. Syntax will not differ, but you will be having Java related exceptions and you will be having Android related exceptions. So all the Java exception classes what you have learned in your core Java, you can use them straight away. Above that, you will be having Android related exception classes. Suppose if you take Bluetooth programming, so when you start transferring the file to the nearby device, suddenly if the device has moved out of surroundings, the file cannot be transferred. So it is a Bluetooth related kind of exception you need to handle. So syntax doesn't vary, it is the same syntax, but you need to be aware of what are the different classes you have, how to handle the Android related exceptions. And the most important thing is in exception handling is you need to guess, or you need to analyze where there is a chance to get an exception. So if you are able to do that, you will be placing all the exception handling measures right in your business logic, where there is a chance that an exception may be raised by your application. So the best part in exception handling is guessing or analyzing the cases where you will be getting some exceptions. So that is the second one, which is important. And third one is concept of threats. Because you are going to run the application on mobile devices, which is having low-end processors, then you'll be having memory in limitation. So both internal and external memory, they'll be limited. So, and multiple applications will be running on the device concurrently. So your application, which is installed by the user, it should not eat the memory available on the device. So categorically, you should get the memory from the device, give it back to the device when the memory is not required by your application. Suppose if you are playing a game, when it is in the foreground, you require some memory because you will be continuously interacting with the game. Suppose if you push the game to the back end, background, you don't require some sort of memory to be allocated to your application. Then you can give the memory back to the device. So this sort of concurrent management you should do with the help of threads in specific to your mobile application. And you can also go through some IO streams kind of thing. So why these IO streams are required is, suppose if you take a WhatsApp application, you will be having the files what you receive from your friends, audio files, video files, all this multimedia content. So everything will go to the file system. You'll be having a specific folder structure, and all the content will be stored categorically in this respective folders. So again, when you want to look into that video file, or when you want to listen to the audio file, again you need to access the folders, you need to go to the correct folder, you need to take the file and read the content. So input stream basically for reading content, output stream basically for writing content. So when you are storing the file, you'll be using the output streams, and then when you are reading, you'll be using the input streams. And you'll be having different classifications also. You'll be having some sort of buffered readers, then buffered writers will be there, then input stream readers will be there. According to the situation, you need to use the respective streams. So these are the four things which are basically important from your Java concepts. And the other one, what is required is web services. So web services, I'll take it as part of your Android course. You need not go through any of these web services concepts in detail. So we'll be doing it in the course itself. And the first four concepts, if you require from some brush up kind of thing, I'll give you some brush up in the weekend so that you'll get ready for the Android application development. And apart from this, you'll be having the XML dependency also. So XML, most of the cases it will be similar to your HTML programming. You'll be having tags, you'll be having the respective attributes and all these things. So same thing what you see in your normal plain HTML, but the tags will be different. Suppose if you take something to give input to the user, input from the user, you'll be using an input tag when you take your HTML coding. In the case of Android, it will be just called as a text view. Another simple example, when you take, you will be having normal labels, but when it comes to Android, it will be called as text view, that which cannot be edited. So just the naming conventions will be different, but the intention will be the same, which is to design the front end, and we'll be doing in Android with XML, not with HTML. So we'll be using XML. So as you keep on practicing that, you'll be knowing what are the different tags and all those things in XML. So one basic use of XML is the presentation layer. Another one where you'll be using XML is for the data exchange in the case of web services. So web services, if you want to send some data from your device to the server, or when you want to read some data from the server into your device, that is data exchange where you'll be using the concept of web services. So when we are dealing with web services, we'll be seeing XML from the data exchange point of view. But when you are designing user interfaces, we'll be seeing XML from the presentation layer point of view. So two different perspectives will be there for XML. And these are the basic things which are required. And now I'll just go into your Android concepts, what will be going and how the course will progress in this 30 to 40 days time. So I'll just give you an overview of what will be there in Android, what concepts exactly you require to develop a particular type of application. So before starting any type of application, the first thing what is important is the category to which it belongs to. You might be seeing on the Google Play Store, you'll be having different categories like you'll be having education, you'll be having communication, you'll be having entertainment like music players and all these things. Then you'll be having social networking apps. These are the different categories. So you need to get an idea on what category your application belongs to. Because if you are developing a social networking kind of application, so you need to more concentrate on data exchange. So if you give some message to your friend, immediately the other person should be able to read your message. There should not be any delays in the communication part once the network is available. If the network is not available, later on synchronizations will be there when the network is available. So if you are developing a social networking kind of application, the protocols you need to concentrate, which will be used for data exchange. Suppose if you are developing a video player kind of application that belongs to the entertainment category, you need to concentrate more on multimedia, because playing audio, then playing video, then if required you will be having online streaming of both audio and video content. So these sort of concepts you need to be thorough when you want to develop an audio player, video player kind of application. And if you want to develop some application like your phone book kind of thing, so phone book normally will be having an offline database, so you need to be good enough in your data storage models which will support offline storage on the device. So if you get a clarity about what type of application you want to develop, what category it belongs to, then you can put more efforts into the concepts that are required to develop that application. So otherwise, if you want to learn everything equally on equal basis, then you can practice all the things parallelly. And my suggestion is better to have an application before the beginning of the course. That means we'll be discussing what are the different types of applications we have already, what type of application we are going to develop, and we'll be discussing about the design of the application, how the development will progress, at what phases you need to test the application, at what points you need to place the application on the Play Store so that users can download your application. Suppose if you are developing some game, you may think of 10 levels in your game initially, but developing 10 levels of the game will take some time. Suppose it is taking 4 to 5 months to develop all the 10 levels. What you can do is take 2 months time, develop the first 5 levels, put it on the Play Store so that people will start using your application, people will start playing the game. After that, after 4 to 5 months, you can develop the next 5 levels and then give it as an update of your application, so that people will keep on moving and they'll be using your application. So this sort of fragmentation should be there when you are developing applications. So you should not think of I should give a big application one day, I need to keep it on the Play Store. No, you should have some progressive improvement, develop some services, ask people to download, next give some updates, some improvements, and parallelly debug the application. Suppose if you are releasing the first version, people when they are using them, they will be writing their reviews, ratings, and all these things will be given. So you need to keep a track of that, and then you need to debug your application. Then in a second update, you need to do all those bug fixes along with the new services, and you need to provide an update. So bug fixing is a very important part of your Android application. So because as a developer, we will be thinking that I am doing the best application today, but no. So people, when they are using your application, they'll be knowing what are the pitfalls, what are the bugs in that, at what points the application is getting slowed down, or which user interfaces are to be made better, or what type of data they are more interested in. So these sort of things, from the users you can get all the inputs. So the statistics which are provided by the users, the feedback which is provided by the users plays a very important role if you want to really make your application very big and to get more number of downloads. So the first one is the category of the application. So we'll be discussing some points about the Play Store and all these things. And after that, I'll just show you the course content, and slowly I'll explain the things one by one. This is the course content, which is a bit advanced, which is designed some 1 month before to this demo. So starting sessions will be going with how the applications will be designed, categorized based on design, or based on who is providing your application, or how your application is behaving once the application is installed on the device. I just give some sample examples. Suppose if you take your design, suppose if I am developing an application that is totally for tablet PC, which is of 7-inch, then it becomes a totally customized application what I develop for a 7-inch tablet PC. So that means I need not look into some other screens, or I need not design the application for some other screen sizes. So the application will be totally dedicated to 7-inch tablet PC. Suppose if I am designing a login page. Design for a 7-inch login page will be different. Design for a 5-inch smartphone will be different. The layout will be totally different, because when you take tablet PC, the width what you have will be greater than height. But when you take your smartphone environment, which is having some a 5-inch display, obviously the height will be greater than width. So the same design will not fit for both the devices. You need to design two XML files. This is what we're discussing. XML here will be used for presentation. So when you are designing these XML files, you need to design two XML files really if you target both the devices. But if I develop the application only for tablet PCs and I'm not bothering about how the application will look on your smartphone, then it totally becomes a customized application only for tablet PCs. So the first categorization, you'll be having customized applications, and then you'll be having dynamic applications. Dynamic applications, once you place it on the Play Store, any user can download your application. Any type of operating system may take your application, that is the Android version, and the application can be installed. So those applications will be dynamic applications. So that is the first categorization, which will be based on design. Next, you'll be having vendor-based classification. That means you'll be having native applications. When you buy a phone, you'll get some applications like your phone book and all these things. Then you'll be having developer applications, what you can download it from the Play Store. Then you'll be having some third-party applications. Suppose if you take some devices, they'll come pre-installed with Facebook, or they'll come pre-installed with Dropbox. It doesn't mean that Dropbox or Facebook is developed by Samsung or LG. So they'll be having some third-party tie-ups, and they will get their applications pre-installed on those devices. So this is the vendor-based classification. And the third classification will be based on the behavior of the application. That means you'll be having foreground applications like your gaming applications. Then you can have some background applications like your, you can take your SMS autoresponders who will respond in from the background. So whether the application is running in the foreground, that means it requires user interactions, or without user interaction, the application is able to manage something. Depending on the behavior, you will be having some applications. So we will look into minute details into this all these things, how these applications will be behaving, and what sort of precautions you need to take about when you are developing a foreground application or a background application. Suppose if you take foreground application, so what is to be managed better is the state of the user interface should be managed better, because the user will be continuously using the application, he will be continuously interacting with the application. So foreground management plays a very important role. But when you take a background application, the background thread management should be better, because when the application is running in the background, it should not stop the user not to use any application in the foreground. So the user should be able to do something in the foreground, and background of the application should be running. Suppose if you take a music player, so if you are listening to some audio content, you cannot keep the music player continuously in the foreground. You can put it in the background and do something in the foreground. Because your music player is running, you should not stop the user without using any application in the foreground. So this sort of management you need to have when you just compare a foreground application with a background application. So this sort of comparisons we'll be looking in detail. And the other one what we'll be looking at is Android architecture. So when you take the type of architectures, generally we'll be having different levels in the architectures, and levels will be having different types of components. And really, you need to look at this architecture depending on your role. That means whether you are an application developer, or if you are a simple mobile phone user, or really if you are an original equipment manufacturer, or the original device manufacturer, like Samsung or LG. These are called as OEMs or ODMs. So when you take this architecture, suppose if you buy a new Android phone, you don't know anything in Android. You're just a simple phone user. You just like the Android operating system and you have bought that. So generally what you concentrate is what type of apps you can install, how much amount of storage I'm getting, what type of display I'm getting, what is the camera, a pixel resolution. So all these things you will just concentrate when you're a simple mobile phone user. But really, if you're an application developer, you need to concentrate something about that. That means you need to know what the Android SDK is providing. Technically, you need to know what are the different components in the architecture. You need to be aware of how the communication is happening across the layers and across the components. So all these things you need to have an idea when you're an application developer. Suppose if you are an original equipment manufacturer, you need to know everything in the Android architecture. That means right from the hardware component, camera, what type of driver should be available, what type of library should be installed on the device, what type of framework should be integrated. Then you should also give a native camera application along with the device. So all these things you need to concentrate when you're an original equipment manufacturer. So as an application developer, the layers what are important in your architecture is, you need to have a design of your application to build the application. Next thing is you need to understand what are the frameworks. So technically what are the different APIs, and then you need to understand what libraries are to be integrated with your application. Suppose if you see some applications, if they are having some login screen, you can log in with the username and password once you register with the application. Or you can still log in using your Facebook, or you can have your Google Plus integration, or you can log in using your Twitter, or you can log in using your Pinterest. So all these things are external libraries. Pinterest is not owned by Google, or Facebook is not owned by Google. So all these things will provide their own SDKs, their own libraries. So wherever you require that integration, you need to add that library dependency, and then you need to do some programming to log in using your Facebook or Twitter. So these sort of libraries you need to know when you are integrating and how to integrate, and the different frameworks, SDKs. Suppose if you are developing a selfie kind of application, you need to access the secondary camera, which will be the front-facing camera of the device. Normally, if you are taking some pictures, you need to access the primary camera, which will be the back-facing camera of your device. So when you are programming, when you push that button to switch between the cameras, your business logic should do something. So you need to know how to access that back-end camera and how to access that front-facing camera. So that means you need to know what are the different frameworks available, what are the different APIs available, what classes you should use, what methods you should call, what are the properties you should get. All these things you need to be aware of. Suppose if you are developing torchlight kind of application. So you require the back-facing camera, and the feature what you require is flash, because continuously it should be in the on state. So to continuously keep this torch in the on state, what method you should call, what property you need to pass. So all these things you should be aware of. So we'll be looking at this architecture, what levels you are having. And so the next thing is we'll be discussing about your Android project. So this is the most important part before you start the course, because initially we'll be discussing about the design of the application. So what application we are going to develop in the course, and we'll be discussing what are the different modules in the application. Suppose if you are developing an application for some university kind of thing, then you'll be having different roles. So if you are planning to develop an application for your university, so then obviously you'll be having many users. All the users will not be on the same level. So you'll be having different roles, like your admin role you'll be having, you'll be having your professor role, then you'll be having your user role, then you can have your student role, and then you'll be having your a common user or the general user who can access the application. So what will be different is the services will be different. As an admin, you can have the combination of all the services. As a professor, some levels, some services will be given. As a student, some more levels will be given, some more services will be given. So this sort of understanding of the design of the application, and this will place us in a clear-cut position on how to progress in this course. So why? Because if you don't have clarity in this project, what you are going to design, then the course will be similar to your YouTube tutorials. So we don't want it to be like that. So when we have a good design, slowly we'll be developing module by module. First module, 4 to 5 screens, second module, 4 to 5 screens. Then we'll integrate the two modules and we'll put them together. Then the third module, then we'll integrate something. So it's a kind of progressive kind of development where by the end of the course, we'll be getting some confidence that I can do this, this kind of application and I can place it on the Play Store. So that is the intention behind designing this application, designing the screens and knowing about the functionality of the application and the workflow of the application first. Not the technical workflow, it's a functional workflow. And so after discussing about this, we'll be first starting with Photoshop, because when you take applications, you'll be having graphics or we call it as icons. Technically speaking, Android, they'll be called as drawables. So we need to design them and we need to place it in the application. So the advantage of getting some skills about how to use Photoshop is, so if you know designing, so you need not wait for some UI developer or some graphic designer to give you the icons according to your requirement. So you can instantly take Photoshop and then you can design your icon and you can try it in your application whether it's looking good or not. If you are not liking, just change the icon, change the color, change some background shade and all these things. So we'll be using the designing tool which is Photoshop. So I'll give you some inputs on how to use this tool and how to design your use cases. And after that we'll be designing your application screens according to the design of the application. So we'll be discussing some design, some functional workflow, and according to that functional workflow, the next module is we'll design the screens. Once we design the screens, then we'll start the development. So that is the process. And after that, we'll be having the installation process. You can install Java, which is required, and after that, Android SDK, and you'll be having Android Studio for the installation. So you can use two environments, Eclipse you can use or Studio you can use, but Eclipse is the Android plugin for Eclipse is retired, so they are not providing any more updates for Eclipse. So everything you can use Android Studio, which is a more flexible environment to develop, then to run your applications, then to test your applications, then your pack your applications and place the APK file on the Play Store. So the best environment what you can use is Android Studio. And once you install that, first we will be looking at the testing environment. So because once you develop some application, you need to test it on multiple platforms, multiple devices. So I may have some device which is having a 5-inch screen size that may be running with a 2 GB RAM, or that will be having some 32 GB internal storage, and which is having some 1.2 GHz processor. This may be one type of specification. Then if you take other device, device 2, which is having some 7-inch, obviously tablet pieces will be running with less amount of RAM, some 16 GB, so let us take 1 GHz processor. So you need to test your application on both the devices, because once your target is to develop a dynamic application where any type of user can install and use your application, so you need to do the testing for n number of devices. So to do the testing on n number of devices, you cannot have all the real devices with you. So you'll be having the concept of emulators or simulators, and it will be called as Android virtual devices. So you can create virtual devices for all the combinations what you want to test your application upon, and then you can test your application on this virtual device. And as well, we'll be testing the application on the active devices or the real devices. So because virtual device testing up to one level, it will be good, but really to test the application, how it is behaving on real devices, so that is the second part. Why? Because if you take, for an example, if you take the concept of locations, geographical locations. So because virtual device will be running on your laptop, so your laptop will not be having any GPS sensor to to get the latitude and longitude. So who will have the GPS sensor? The active device will be having the GPS sensor. So when you are testing on a virtual device, what you can use is mock location. But when you test it on the real device, you will be having the real locations, because what will be available, the GPS sensor will be available. So some sort of initial testing, you can do it on the virtual device, but the other level of testing you need to do with your active device. And the third level of testing is, you'll be having a cloud-based testing. This will be called as remote real devices. That means you can have one or two phones with you, but you cannot have all the real devices with you that are available in the market. So you can access some open source clouds, cloud environments, so which will, you can place a request for the device. So remote consoles will be available, that environment will be given to you. You can request, once the device is allotted for a specific period of time, you will be having a 10 minute slot or 20 minute slot, depending on your case study or depending on your use case you want to test. You can request for that time, and once you once your testing is finished, give it back to the cloud. So that will be called as remote real device testing, where the advantage is you cannot have all the real device with you, so you can opt for this cloud based testing. You will be having open source clouds and you will be having paid clouds. Suppose if you take a device you want to test, they may give you free of cost some 3 or 4 times, but for the 5th time, 6th time, they will be charging you money. So this sort of permutations and combinations will be there. I'll give you some open source cloud environments where you can do your testing on the cloud. So that is the testing part, and after that we'll be going through a first Android application. So we'll be creating the application according to the design what we have discussed, because we'll be designing some graphics by this time. You'll be having some inputs, some icons will be there. So using all those things, we'll be creating your application, and basic input should be given. Suppose when you're creating your Android application, you need to provide what is your application name, what are the Android versions your application is going to target. So all these inputs you need to point of time also. Suppose if you take today you are saying the minimum version that is required for your Android application is 4.4.2. So you cannot keep the same thing as a minimum one in the long run, because the minimum one what you are having today, after 1 year it will become old. You will not be having any devices that are running with 4.4.2 after 1 year or 2 years. So similarly, suppose if you take today, you are having some 6.0 and 7.0 is on the road. So then you will be having, suppose if you take 6.0 is the minimum now. So after 1 year, 2 years, 6.0 will become older. The number of users for this will become less. Suppose if you take, for example, suppose if you go to this dashboard kind of thing, you'll be getting some analysis. So on developer.android.com, you'll be having a platform-wise distribution. Suppose if you take this distribution, 4.4 is having the highest percentage of users today. Then you're having 6.0, then you're having 5.1, then you're having 5.0. Suppose if you make some 4.1 as your minimum one, and 6.0 as the maximum one, if you exclude this some 3%, almost you can get 97% of the devices that can use your application. That means out of 100, you can get 97 users who can install your application. It's not about they should install your application. That means your application will get the eligibility to get installed on 97 users out of 100 users. So this is platform-wise distribution. And this percentage will not be static. You'll be getting new versions which will be added to this table. These versions will become older. As they are becoming older, this percentage will get reduced. So slowly you need to change your application's version compatibility according to the latest trends and latest distribution. This is according to the platforms. This is according to the screen sizes. You'll be having different types of screens. Small screens will be there, normal, large screens, and extra large screens. So this is the distribution. Suppose if you take high density screens, 40% you have. Then somewhat bigger, you are having 30%. So almost 70%, then MDPI, 80%, then the last one is bigger environments. So you are having, now you are having your Android TVs and all these things. So this is the distribution with respect to screen sizes. So you need to carefully follow these trends, and slowly you have to change the configurations of your application. So these inputs you can give it initially when you are designing your application, when you are first time creating your application, but later on you should also change this configuration parameters. So we'll be creating the Android application, and after that your application is created now, you already have the test environment. We will test this basic application on this testing environment, both on the virtual device as well as on the real device. And after that, we'll be looking in detail into the Android project structure. Suppose if you create an Android project like this, so internally you'll be having different files, you'll be having different folders. So you need to understand what folders are there. So if you take a particular folder, what you can create in that folder, what type of resources it can take, and what are the standards you need to follow to create those resources. Suppose if you take this folder, this is having some icon. This is for HDPI. This is for how these components are connected and what standards you need to follow to develop all these kinds of applications. So we'll be discussing in detail what applications, components you are having, this complete folder structure. And slowly we will elaborate into the details of this files. Suppose if you take this manifest file, this is a single file what you are looking at. But when you open this file, you'll be having something which you should go into the things very deeply. Suppose if you take this, suppose when you are seeing any Android application, so if you go to the Google Play Store, and so if you take some application like Twitter, so if you come down here, you'll be in the segment which is called as permissions. Just click on this. So this application, when you are installing, before you install, it will request something from the device. What it is requesting is, it is going to read your contacts. I'm just highlighting what you can understand easily. So locations, approximate locations means network based tracking, precise locations, exact locations, highly accurate location if you want to get GPS based tracking. So this application is going to receive your text messages. It is going to read your phone status and identity, your IMEI number and all these things. So it is read the contents of your USB storage. It is going to take pictures and record videos. It is going to record audio. All these things, this Twitter application is requesting, because it requires all these features from the device, because it has something that the business logic that what it has written in this application is something dependent on all these features. So it is requesting at the installation time that all these features I'm just going a bit technical into the coding. So anyway, we'll go through all these things later on also. Suppose if you want to get access to the camera, this is the one I should do. I should request this camera permission. So if you want to access the Bluetooth of the device, I should request for this permission. If you don't request at this point, at the time of installation, nothing will be requested by the application from the device. So if you are not requesting, nothing will be granted by the device. So these sort of things you should specify in your manifest file. And similarly, you'll be having one more file which is called as build.gradle file. So this is very specific to the Android Studio. In Eclipse, you'll not be having this file. So in Android Studio, it's a separate build environment to build your Android application. So we'll be discussing all these things in detail. So the manifest file and the Gradle build. And after that, once you understand the application structure, then we'll be slowly starting with your views, user interface components, and designing your layouts. So you'll be having different types of layouts what you can design using XML. Suppose if you go to your websites like Pinterest. So suppose if you go to this first page and search for something like Android UI design, or specifically if you go for so you'll be getting some designs like this. This is not what you can download and integrate in your application. So seeing this, you can get some idea about what type of screens you can design, in what way you can design, what colors you need to use, and then what type of graphics you can integrate. And suppose if you take this login screen, this is one type of design, this is another type of design. This is one type of layout, this is another type of layout. So this is a bit of background color combination in the gradient fashion. So this is totally an image that is kept in the background. So the combination of this orange and then this plain blue color and the dark blue color. So it's just a combination. So depending on this, we'll be slowly starting your designing of the layouts, and internal to the layouts we'll be placing different types of views. So views is nothing but, suppose if you take this, this is an image view. This is an input box, this is an input box, this is a normal link, this is a button. So all these things, suppose if you take this, a button is there, but the outer stroke is also drawn. If you take this button, you are having some rounded rectangle. So all these things we'll discuss in detail, how to place different components. So this is a checkbox. So slowly we'll be going, see, this is a tab, sign in and sign up. So you can have two different screens in the same page itself. So all these things will go in detail, and you'll be having the styling concepts also, because you cannot design the screen black and white. So you'll be having some color schemes you need to concentrate. So because front end is what make the user to sit on your application first, then if he will come to your performance. If the UI is not looking so well, then normally people will not like your application. So you can go for this, and you can choose different types of color combinations for your screens, and then slowly you can get into your application. It's all permutations and combinations. For one type of screen you design, you'll be knowing whether it's looking good or bad, then change some colors, change some designs, then develop the second pattern. It's all based on the time what you have and the efforts what you're putting in to design these screens. So, and all these back end, the front end part, what we'll be doing here, and after that, the front end will be the concept of activity. So here your actual Java business logic will start. Until this point, you don't require any Java knowledge, you don't require any type of Java brochure. But from here, you need to understand the Java concepts. So when I'm writing some business logic, you need to understand what I am writing, and when I write something, you should be able to know what that write-up will be used for. So these activities, the comparison, if you take a web application, front end you'll be using HTML, or you can use JSPs. If you're familiar with .NET, you can use ASP pages. But mobile applications, when you take Android, so you'll be having the concept of activities, so which will be a combination of two files. First one will be a Java class, other one will be a XML file. So by this point we'll be see, we have seen already what is XML. The one what we'll be writing here is Java class. So Java class will have the business logic. It's normally the business type. So backend will be your XML, which is your presentation type. So when the user is interacting with your application, suppose you will have this application. So I may click on this login sign in button, or I may click on this keep me signed in, or I can click on this forgot password. So when the user clicks on any one of these things, what should happen? That will be written inside your business logic, which is your Java class. So activities in detail will be behind the life cycle, because you need to manage the state of the activity. So state of the activity means you'll be behind different types of events. That means when you are interacting with the activity, it will be in the running state. Suppose when you are interacting with the activity, suppose if you are typing a message, you may get an incoming call, which is always possible. So then your activity will be in the stopper state. Suppose when you are playing, but if you get an incoming call, your activity will go into the background, your current application will go into the background, and the dial pad application with the incoming call screen will come into the foreground. So pause state, then you can resume your game. From the background, you can restart your application. When you don't require your application, your activity can be killed. These are all different types of events. So the implementation will be different for all these different types of events. Suppose if you are pausing your game, you need to say the current score, what level he is playing, and all these things. Suppose if you are pushing the game into the background, you have clicked the home button. So some resources that the game is utilizing should be released, because your game is not in the foreground. So all these things you need to handle in the better possible way. Able to hear me now, Bhargavi? Fine. So when you are doing your activity lifecycle, you need to understand what are all these events, and you need to write the business logic for all these events. So that will be the activity lifecycle. And after that, we'll be looking into some debugging tools. So it's not about developing something and placing it on the Play Store. In between, you'll be having the debugging part, where you'll be using some sort of testing tools or debugging tools, and you need to test your application. Suppose if you take your hierarchy viewer, this is for front-end analyzing your XML files. So once you develop some XML file, different types of controls will be placed in that. You need to know how the controls are organized, whether they are properly behaving or not, whether they are sitting in the correct places or not. So all these things you need to test using this tool. And functionalities, you'll be testing using this Dalvik debug monitor. So you'll be having some sort of technical tools you'll be knowing about to debug your Android application. Suppose if you take this process of obfuscating. So obfuscation is nothing but, this will also be applied in for your Java applications also. So obfuscation, the basic idea behind this is, it will make the process of reverse engineering tough. So that means when you are giving your APK file to the user, the question is about generating the Java syntax. This process is reverse engineering. From the APK file, you will be generating the Java syntax. When you don't obfuscate your code, this process will become easier. When you obfuscate your code, this Java syntax may will not be generated. That means obfuscating is one step, optimizing is another step. Optimizing means, suppose when I am designing my application, I will be using some logo for my application, logo 1. So when I am testing the application, it is not looking better for me. Then I will take another application which is logo 2. Then I will take another application which is logo 3. Finally, the 10th logo is okay for me, I am using this. When I am using this, it is my responsibility to remove all these logos from my application. if you are keeping as it is and if you are providing your application to the user, it is not an optimized application, because unnecessary resources are there in your application which will be of no use. So you need to optimize your application, you need to obfuscate your application, to compress your APK file, and ensuring that unnecessary code is not present in your application. So this is where you will be having some tools like ProGot, which will help in the process of optimization and obfuscating. And after that, after generating the first screen kind of thing, we will see the process of how to place the application on the Play Store. So once you place the application on the Play Store, you will be getting a link. Suppose if you take your Facebook application, so if you see this URL, this is a search what you are making. If I change this to some Twitter, I get it with a Twitter related search. When I click on this, this specific application you are accessing. So if you see here, you are having an ID for your application. What is the ID? com.twitter.android. So if you take another application, suppose if you take this Fabric application, this will have a different ID. So every application will be given some ID once it is placed on the Play Store. That means if you are using this same ID for your application will not be allowed. Why? Because there is already an application on the Play Store with this ID. So the unique property for your application is your ID. Technically we call it as package name. So when you are placing your application on the Play Store, you should not have any other application on the Play Store with the same ID. Suppose if I am using some Ketan dot, some trainings dot, app dot, so it's my Sun Trainings application, some Android. So if I type here, obviously it will not return anything, because with this package name or with this ID, no application is available on the Play Store. So if I just use it as Ketan, then also it is not written anything. Suppose if you take the other category, suppose take this, you can get my application. So this is my application as an Android client. So this also you will be having a specific ID here. So if you are using this ID, you will be getting the details. So these type of things you should do before you place your application on the Google Play Store. So you'll be having a process of signing your application, and you'll be having something which is important to feed in to prepare your application. So you should have a license, which is your developer license. So this developer license, it will be costing you around $25. This is a one-time fee what you need to pay. After that, you can place any number of applications from your Google publisher account. So you can also search. So you can just log in into your Google address. I'll just sign out and show you. Suppose if you take this, so if you go to Google publisher account, so this is your Play Store URL, play.google.com, apps/publish. So when you access this link, you can log in using your Gmail credentials. You can log in and see, but without paying this $25, you will not be able to place your application on the Play Store. So this is around 1500 rupees in Indian currency. Once you pay that, you will be getting a license. And then you can place any number of applications from your Play Store. So we'll be seeing that process in detail, how to publish it on the Play Store. And the next one is the concept of fragments. So fragments and activities are interrelated. Suppose if I'm having this footer, the presentation layer or the business logic, I need not repeat in all these three activities, because every activity, as we discussed, is a combination of Java plus XML. Login will have one Java file, one XML file. Dashboard will have one Java file, one XML file. So I need not repeat this footer in all the XML files and in all the Java files. So what we do is, I'll write this footer as a fragment. So it is a one-time process. And whenever I require, wherever I require, I will include this fragment. If I want the footer in login, I'll include it in the login. If I want it in the dashboard, I'll include it in the dashboard. So I need not write the same thing multiple times in my application. So this concept, you'll be calling it as fragments in Android. Normally in your HTML content, you'll be calling it as frames. Design some frames wherever you want to, you just include the frames. So that is a concept of fragments. And after that, we'll be going through some advanced user interfaces. So how to customize the user interfaces, how to draw the user interfaces according to your requirement. Suppose if you take some user interfaces, suppose if you take this, see, this is also a list, 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 but it is customized according to the requirement. Here I need to place some icon, I need to place some text. Here I need to place some text, I need to place a checkbox to the right side. It is also a scrollable list, this is also a scrollable list. But the difference is, data is different, the presentation is also different. Android will just provide you a list. You need to customize it according to your requirement, according to your own design. Suppose if you take the concept of dialogues, when you are coming out of the application, one application will just ask you for a confirmation. Are you sure you want to quit or not? Some applications, when you are quitting, they will ask for some feedback on the dialog box. That means the dialog box will be customized according to the requirement of the developer, and then the dialog box will be provided. So all these things will fall under advanced UI, customizations, custom UI components and all these things. So we'll be looking in detail one by one how you can customize the things. Right. So after that you'll be having material design, so which is a new concept. And material design is just a concept of a styling, and you'll be having some advanced concepts. It's also the UI part, but advanced with respect to the user interfaces, how you can make it more better with lesser customizations. So that is our material design. After that, we'll be using the concept of intents. So intents, basically, suppose if you take the same example, login, dashboard and contact us. When you click on login button, you should go to dashboard. Suppose when you click on contact us page on your dashboard, you should go to the contact us page. So what is happening here is navigation, which is transfer of control from one component to another component. So this transfer of control will be done using the concept of intents. So a transfer of control as well as data passing from one component to another component. So data passing means, suppose if you take your Gmail application, first you will have your login screen, next you will have your inbox. So inbox, it will display the list of mails. Login page, what it will do, it will send a request to the server and it will wait for the response. So response, what you will get is, you will get the list of mails from the server related to your account. But all these mails, what this login page is receiving, are not displayed on the login page. They are displayed on the inbox page. That means this is receiving the data. Data from this login is passed to this inbox. And when you want to pass the data, you will be using the concept of intents. So intents will be used for transfer of control as well as data passing from one component to another component. And you might be having some requirement in your application. I want to take a picture, or I want to make a call, or I want to open the browser to access some link. Then if you want to do any of these three things, you need not design a separate camera application, camera component from your application. What you can use, the native camera application you can use. If you want to make a call, you can access your dial pad application. If you want to open some web page, you can access the browser of the device which is already available. So these things are internally available on the device. So you can also access all these things without developing the same thing in your application. So what will happen here is, so this 5 minutes continuously the network should be available. So if the network is not available, so if you are having any breakdown in between, this downloading process will not continue. So your Gmail application which is downloading the attachment should know that the network is lost. So if the network is lost, your download will not continue. So how this will happen is, you will be having a manager which is called as connectivity manager, which will monitor the different types of networks, and this will be knowing whenever a network state is changed. Your application cannot know directly. Who will know first? The connectivity manager will know. Immediately what it will do is, it will broadcast a message internal to the device saying that the network state is changed. It's a kind of alert kind of thing to all the applications on the device. That means all the applications will be able to listen to this message whenever the state is changed. But the dependency is your application should have a receiver who should listen to this message which is broadcast. It will be similar to your FM station. FM station will broadcast some signals. On your mobile, if you want to listen to those signals, first you should have a receiver. If the FM receiver is not present, you will not be able to listen to the signals. So once the receiver is present, you should also do some frequency matching. If the signals are getting broadcasted at some frequency 100.1, so your frequency matching should also be done to 100.1. So similar process, you will be having the frequency matching here. That means your receiver should be registered with the message that is broadcasted. So this is the concept of broadcast receivers which will be used for event handling. Suppose a similar example, a simple example to understand. You will have a dial pad application, your dial application on your device. Now, what are the different events? Incoming call. Now, when somebody calls you, automatically what will come to the home page? The incoming call screen. So when this incoming call screen is coming to the home page, you can see the number from whom you are getting the call. So what happens here is, this dial pad application will have a receiver that will be automatically called when the telephone state is changed. So telephone state, if there is no call, you'll be in the idle state. If there is an incoming call, it will come to the ringing state. That means there is a change in the telephone. Who will be notified immediately? Receiver. Where is this receiver? In your dial pad application. So what this receiver will do is, it will write a query to the contact book database. Why? Because it will check whether there is any contact with this number from whom you are getting the call. So if the contact is there, it will display the contact name on the incoming call screen. Otherwise, only the number will be displayed. That is the reason when you get a call from somebody who is already added to your phone book, automatically you will get that name. So who will write the query to the contact book database? This receiver will write the query to the contact book database with this number and it will try to fetch that name. So if you don't have that contact in your phone book, only the number will be displayed on your incoming call screen. So, but who should be activated first? This receiver should be activated. So this is the concept of broadcast receivers. And next we'll be having the concept of threads and background services. So background services, they'll be used for long-running jobs. So long-running jobs, suppose if you take this example, I'm downloading an attachment. It is approximately taking 5 minutes time. So I cannot block the user not to open any application for these 5 minutes. So this downloading of the attachment should be done in the background. It should be pushed to the background, but it should run in the background, and in the foreground the user can do something else. So long running jobs, you should have to implement using background services as well. You should also have the implementation of threads. So you'll be having different types of threads provided by Android, like your UI thread. All the user interfaces will run on the UI thread. You'll be having some background threads. You'll be having binder threads. So we need to understand what each and every thread can do. Depending on the situation, what thread you should use. So when you are running a background job on the UI thread, that's it. User will be blocked. User cannot do anything. So appropriate tasks, appropriate threads you need to start and you need to run your application. So these things, all these things will fall under the first part of your Android, which will take approximately 20 to 25 days time. And after that, we'll be starting the APIs part. So APIs part, basically, I'll not go into much of the details because I think you might be feeling boring. So I'll just give you the concepts, what APIs will be used. And the first one will be offline data storage. So because you cannot save the data, everything to a remote server every time. So some of the data should be saved offline on the device. So you'll be having different data storage models, like your file system storage, like your internal and external storage. And then you'll be having the database, which is SQLite, where you can create databases, you can create some tables. So you can do all the transactions. You can insert, you can update, you can delete, or you can write some query and get the data. So we'll be seeing, depending on the requirement, what type of storage you can use and what are the advantages and disadvantages, what type of scenarios with storage model should be implemented. All these things we'll be seeing in the offline storage. And this offline storage can also be shared with other applications. That means if you take contact book database, the contacts API, you can access it from your SMS application. You can access it from your WhatsApp application. Then your Facebook can also synchronize your contact book. It can write all the Gmail contacts or sorry, Facebook contacts to your Facebook, to your contact book. The Gmail application can also synchronize your phone book. It can write all the Gmail contacts to your phone book. So sharing of data with other applications will be the concept of content providers. So if you're having some database, if you want to share it with other applications on the device, then you have to write some content provider and you have to publish the API so that other applications can access your data. So that is offline data storage models. And after this, we'll be handling the concept of web services. So web services, this will be the most interesting part, because you'll be handling the online data, and every application today, if you see, it's almost data synchronized. So you'll be getting data from the server. Once you have a good internet connection, data will be flowing in easily and it can flow out easily. So online data, it will be exchanged between a server plus a client. So in our case, the client is the Android application. Or once the web service is ready, you can also access the service from an iOS application, or you can access the web service from the web application like your websites. So client can be anything, server can be anything, but what is important is how the data is exchanged. What are the protocols? That means you can exchange the data in XML format, or you can exchange the data in the JSON format. So I'll just show you a simple example of web services, how it will work. Suppose if you go to Google Maps directions API, just you can go to this, and if you access this, so just go to this modes of transport, or you can go to these guides also. Just copy this URL. I'll just write it here first. Right. So I'm removing some of the content which you cannot understand at this point. So I'm changing this XML JSON to XML. It is asking for some origin and some destination. So I'll just give it as some New Delhi, and the other one is Hyderabad. So if you copy this and if you write it here, so you are getting the data in the JSON format here, and so you can also get the data in the XML format. So there is some problem with the browser. Fine. So you'll be getting some tags like this, and you'll be getting the data. So once you get this data, it will give you the directions from one location to another location, how you can reach, what points will be there in between, and how you can get all those data. Suppose if you see here, right. So if you see this point, what is the distance between two locations, how much duration it will take, end location, start location, and what are the instructions. So you have to head towards some Rajpath Road towards Motilal Nehru Mark. So you will be getting the voice commands, right? When you start your Google Maps Navigator, before you reach some point, you will be listening to what direction you need to take to reach that point. So those are all the instructions. So this path will be a combination of multiple steps. As you go down, you can see multiple steps, and the information will be different. See, if you see here, it is asking you to turn right onto some Himyon Road and pass by Rajbhut Singh Junior Model School. And if you see the next instruction, it will be different. So it is asking you to turn left onto Rajesh Pilot Mark. Next instruction will be different. So until you reach the endpoint, your destination, all these instructions will be slowly read out. This will be called as text-to-speech in Android. You are having some text here that is to be converted into voice. It is called as text-to-speech, which is a multimedia concept, but to listen to the voice commands. So these things, this is a simple web service. You need to consume this web service into your mobile application. So because directly you cannot display this data as it is to the user, you have to consume this, read this entire thing, pick the content, whatever you require, and then display it to the user. So that part will be called as consuming part. So we'll be having two things. First one is the publishing part, other one is consuming part. So publishing part will be done on a server, consuming part will be done on the client. And as well, we'll be seeing the concept of parsing. We'll be seeing different types of parsers, because you need to read the XML content, you need to read the JSON content. So to read and write, you'll be using the concept of parsers. So because that most one advantage of web services is, suppose if you take a server, the disadvantage what we have is portability. You cannot move the server everywhere you go, but the advantage what you get with a server is storage. Similarly, if you compare this with your mobile, so the advantage what you get is portability, but the disadvantage what you have is storage. So the advantage of portability will be combined with the advantage of storage on the server, and data will be exchanged between the mobile and the server. So this exchange of data will be done using web services. So we'll see clearly how to write the server side part and how to write the client side part and how to consume these web services and how to do the parsing process. And after this, we'll be handling the concept of location-based services. So how to get the locations using your GPS, and the other type of tracking is network. So if you see some comparisons, this will be you get the location with high accuracy, but at the same time it will consume high power. Fetching will be a bit slow because the communication will be with the satellites. Process will be a bit slow. You have to wait for some time to get the location, but here less accurate. It will consume low power. You'll be having fast fetching because it depends on the network, either your cellular connection or you can also use your Wi-Fi. So some sort of differences will be having between GPS based fetching and location based fetching, or network based fetching. And finally, what you get from this is latitude and longitude. Latitude and longitude, just some sort of decimal numbers, and you'll be having some precision on this. So if you go to your Google Maps, so if you search for some location, so this location will be a combination of latitude and longitude. Suppose if you see this, this is the latitude and longitude. Suppose if you show these numbers to the user, he will not be able to understand what are these numbers. So this has to be converted into an address of this type. So for this process, we will be using a geocoder, which will be used to convert the address into latlongs and vice versa. From the latlongs, you can also get the address. So geocoding concept you need to do really to show the address to the user, because address is the most important thing the user can do. In the background, you get the latitude and longitude, get the accurate location, slowly geocode it and convert it into address and display the address to the user. So once you get this address here, then after that we'll be going through your Google Maps integration. So first we'll be having some registration process to access the Google Maps data. So you need to generate some keys, which will be the authentication tokens between your application and the map servers. So that falls under registration. And after that, we'll be looking at how to display the maps and to add different types of markers. Suppose we see this marker is added here. This is the entire map what is being displayed, but your exact location is here. It can be somewhere else or it can be somewhere else. How that will be identified? If you display a marker here, it will be identified. Suppose if you roll over onto this, you will be getting some information window. It is having an image, it is having some text. So these type of information windows, we'll be looking at how to customize them and how to use your Google Maps and directions. So all these things will be discussed in Google Maps. Then we'll be looking at how to make calls on how to send SMS and all these things. And then we'll be going through your multimedia concepts, how to play audio, how to play video, how to use the camera API to capture the pictures or record the video. Exactly two opposite process, voice recognition and text-to-speech. Voice recognition speaks something, get the phrases. Text-to-speech, write something and give the voice commands. So this process will hang in multimedia and we'll be looking at in detail customization of the camera. So if you want to access the camera according to your requirement, then we need to customize the camera. So this customization we'll be looking in detail, how to access the front cam, how to access the back cam, how to capture pictures according to the size what you require. Suppose if your application requires a size of 100 by 100, if you are taking the pictures for some thumbnail or your profile pictures, then the size should be less, the resolution should be less, the quality you can compromise. So all these things you can customize according to your requirements. So that is camera. Then we'll be going through Bluetooth, how to access Bluetooth and how to control the things using Bluetooth, how to send the files from one device to another when they are nearby to each other. So all these things. And then we'll be having social networking integrations. We'll be seeing Facebook and we'll be seeing Google Plus. So you can log in into your application using the username and password, what you have registered with the application's database. Or if you don't require that registration, you can log in using your Facebook or Google Plus. You might be seeing on many applications, you'll be having this social networking authentication processor. And after that, you'll be having cloud messaging. Cloud messaging is for push notifications. Suppose normal notification is different. If you take an alarm application, there is an alarm manager, which will just give you the notification according to the time you configure. But if you take Flipkart or Amazon and all these things, you'll be getting some notifications some days when you're having some sales and all these things. So what they'll do is, from the server side, they'll send some notifications, some messages. All the applications which are running on the Android or iOS, where they have the notification managers, all that applications will receive the notification. So that immediately you'll know that some offer is running on Flipkart or some sales are going on Amazon.com. So for all these push notifications, cloud messaging, you'll be having this Firebase cloud messaging. The previous version, we call it as GCM, Google Cloud Messaging. It was just renamed and some of the features were introduced. And we'll be looking at how to write the client and how to receive all those messages sent from the server. So this is totally the course what we have. And it will take 35 to 40 sessions, and sometimes even more than that, depending on how fast we are moving and what type of application we take up in the beginning. Because an application with 10 screens will be different, with 20 screens will be different. So it will take some time according to the application what you're taking and according to the depth of what you're going into the subject. That's it from my side. So if you're having any doubts or any queries, you can come up with your queries. Yes, Sanjay.
Hello Sindhu, this is Anjali.
Yeah, hi, please.
So I just wanted to know, like, what would be the fees for this course?
Fee you can discuss with the Sun Trainings management. So I'm
Okay. Okay. Okay, fine, I'll ask them.
okay.
Okay.
And you are good at Java programming.
See, I haven't been, done too much in the Java, but when I was studying that time, I learned bit of Java. But in my job, I never got an opportunity to work in Java. But I have worked with C, C++, object-oriented technology, and later on Visual Basics. So I can
Okay.
understand the Java code. Yeah, I can
Say
understand.
object-oriented programming, if you have good idea, it will be better.
Yeah, I have
Coding.
done C++, yeah, C++,
Or otherwise, basically, because by the time you get into actual Java programming, so it will take almost 1 week to 10 days time, because initially you will be having this XML designing part and all these things. So by the time you can just go through some good YouTube tutorials regarding these basic concepts.
Actually, I have, that confidence that I can definitely understand the Java code, I can, pick up the Java programming because I
Okay.
have worked in, object-oriented technology and, like now.
Then my suggestion is better concentrate on the concept of threads meanwhile. Just go
Threads.
a bit of that dip into threads. So that'll help in a better way.
Okay. So it would be the training sessions would be every day, or it would be only over the weekends, like how it would be?
It will be every day. Obviously, it will be 6 days in a week.
Okay.
And
Monday to
initially,
Saturday?
this is Monday to Saturday. And
Okay.
initially, I'll be taking 5 days in a week for the first 2 weeks, because you need to practice and then you need to understand better, right? So once you are doing better, then I can spend some extra time. Otherwise, it will be a rush up kind of thing. It will end up with nothing if I rush up.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, in the beginning, it takes time for students to, grasp the concept and, yeah, so.
That considerable time I'll be giving you initially, but after completing 10 days, 15 days, taking it that you're practicing everything, I'll be taking some extra time.
Okay, so it's around 45 days, right? Per 1 hour per day.
Yes.
Okay, so
And
around 1 hour.
sometimes even if you go 1 week more than that also, because if you can give me some extra time, I can teach you some more extra concepts, or we can
Okay.
go a bit of depth into that.
Okay. Because the thing is, like, 1.5 months from now would be around December, right?
Yes.
Yeah, so like we are traveling to India in December
Okay.
for a month, and
December one day.
I'll be traveling on 10th December.
Oh, 10 December. And that also, this course, how this course will progress is, I'll take it from the high priority to low priority. That means in the first 1 month, 35 days, around 30 to 35 days, all the important things I'll complete. Suppose if you take web services, and if you have comparison with Bluetooth, web services is the important one. So when you compare with Bluetooth, see, Bluetooth is important for Android, but comparing with Bluetooth web services, Bluetooth will be pushed to the towards the end of the course.
Okay, understand.
So that way we'll proceed.
So, would you be covering NFC also?
NFC, if you require, I take it.
Okay. So
You require
I would love,
NFC?
yeah, definitely I would love to learn for the NFC also. Yeah.
Done.
So Sindhu, the thing is, now I would like to start it earlier so that I can finish it before I travel to India.
Yes.
maybe next week sometime. Can is it possible?
Most probably Wednesday or Thursday we'll start it.
Wednesday or Thursday, okay, then it's good. Okay, yeah. And Sindhu, I was just wondering, since I'll be traveling to Hyderabad, like, do you suggest that, you know, like something which you like think like can be a practical, you know, things like in person only you can teach. So if while I'll be in Hyderabad, I can come to your center or I can attend that. Is something like that also there?
That particular thing, if these sun trainings people, they are having an institute. So if they give me a chance to come down there, so we'll have a half day workshop kind of thing, so that you can do it in practice.
So you are a freelancer trainer, or you?
No, I work in a company. I work with Center for Good Governance.
Okay.
It is into e-governance and m-governance. So.
Wonderful.
So basically, in the morning and evening, I teach this.
Yeah, because I'm really impressed the way you explain this demo session, and that's why I ask you the question. Sometimes it happens that in the demo session they get the good trainer, but in the real time training the trainers would be different.
No, you can come down once you reach Hyderabad, you can give me a call. So somehow you can do it somewhere.
Yeah, sure. So I'm just you know I'm going to speak to some trainings, and I definitely hope that you would be the person who will be taking the training, because
I'll be taking the training. There is no doubt about that.
okay. Fine then. Because you know, like this demonstration with sun training for me has been, you know, on and off. So I was not really sure if I would like to go ahead with sun trainings. But
no.
After having today's demo, I'm happy, you know.
Yeah.
I would like to learn it from you, Android programming.
Yes. No, I'll be teaching.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay.
And what about your Madhu Bhargavi? Bhargavi? Fine. So, Ravi on the other side, sun trainings. Fine. Okay then, bye Anjali. Bye Madhu. Bye.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye.